December brought cooler water, and her skin prickled as she dived in. Visibility was only about 15 feet because of the swell, but it hardly mattered, because she knew every contour of the reef, all the resident fish families, and even the local black-tip sharks that patrolled the coastline. With each kick, the knots in her back loosened. Working 6 days a week took a toll on her, but who else was going to earn the money? Certainly not her mom, Louise. And without the money, there would be no food and no house. As Daisy moved along, clouds gave way to sunlight that warmed her back. Schools of yellow tang and manini parted around her, glowing. Her route took her out about 100 yards before she veered right along a ledge that dropped onto a sandy floor. Tufts of red limu grew out of the cracks, and spiny wana dotted the coral. She kept an eye out for shell trails. Then, all around her, the water hummed. She tasted fuel on her tongue. She popped her head up and scanned the horizon for any signs of a ship. But soon it was obvious the sound was not coming from the sea, but rather the sky. Several planes buzzed just overhead before banking and heading toward the pineapple fields. Then another, and another. Must be more military training. But on Sunday? She dived and continued on. With the swell also came current, and she fought to stay on course. It took her twice as long to reach her destination, though along the way she plucked two hand-sized tiger cowries hiding in a crevice. Those often brought a good price. When she reached part of the reef full of lobster holes, Daisy set her spear on a coral head and put on her gloves. Lucky thing the tide was low. The first few holes were empty, but she finally caught sight of a set of spindly antennas. Her heart dropped. That hole was off limits. Last time, she'd nearly had her arm taken off by a moray eel as thick as her torso. She passed by the other holes again, stuck her hand in a few, but came up with nothing. Hungry and tired after a long week at the ranch, she decided to head back to Moon. The current had picked up, and she fought to make any headway, dreaming of scrambled eggs, steamed watercress, and Portuguese sausage. As she approached the beach, the water started buzzing again. She kept swimming and kicked down after a papillo. Military maneuvers had ramped up lately, but she never paid them any mind. There were more immediate things to worry about. By now, the buzzing had turned into a deep vibration of the water all around. When she came up for air, she found a rock to stand on to see what was happening. From behind the ironwood trees, less than 50 feet over the water, a plane with red circles under its wings zoomed toward her, passing directly over her head, followed closely by an olive-green plane with a white star on its side, the kind she was used to seeing, a P-40 Warhawk. The rat-tat-tat of gunfire had her diving back into the water. What kind of idiots were these, shooting real guns over a residential area? Anger bunched in her chest. Unless. From shore came a loud whinny. She saw Moon rear up on the rope, his front hooves pawing at the air. Daisy half swam, half ran toward the beach, desperate to get to him and calm him down. The lead plane suddenly pulled up its nose, flew straight up, and banked around. They were both heading back toward the shoreline, weaving only a dozen feet off the water. She dived to the bottom again and held on to a rock for as long as her lungs would allow. After coming up for air, she made a mad dash for Moon. To hell with the planes. She was almost to him when the rope snapped. She reached out, her hand closing around the frayed edge, burning as the rope slipped through. And then he was gone.
Moon, no!
Daisy screamed. He was tearing down the beach toward Haleiwa at a full gallop. She took a few desperate strides after him.